program that we have and a number of interactions with visiting scholars and students from around the world, visiting in both directions. So there are people from my university who go overseas to study in other places or to teach, and vice versa. We receive many people from around the world. So it's just a means of learning a little bit more about those programs. All right. That wasn't what I wanted. This computer. Yesterday, when we talked about the tropical dendroecology, we discussed that article was a review of the state of knowledge about using species in the tropics. And there were a number of points about how people have tried to study tree growth in the tropics in different ways, for instance, using permanent plots, or using wounding or pinning of trees in order to determine when exactly the cell formation occurs, so that you can try to see if rings are actually being formed annually. This is an extremely interesting paper because of a figure. So you can read the part in English, the other part is in Indonesian. I don't know if anyone speaks Indonesian. So if we go down, let's see. So this is a study of a pine. So it's a pine species called Pinus mercusia. It's a very interesting species. I don't know if it ranges into the eastern part of India, but it is in Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, and Indonesia.
No, Indusi. Pinus Indusi. This is what is this species?
Mercusia. It starts with an M.
Pinus acacia is there.
Okay. But it comes close to that region. It's an unusual pine species because it's the southernmost native range of a pine. Pines are northern hemisphere species. They've been planted a lot in the southern hemisphere, in South Africa and Chile, but they are native to the northern hemisphere, except for this one, which actually crosses the equator in Indonesia. And what you're looking at there are increment cores. You can see a long section of core and then a close-up of each one. There are three different ecotypes. These are the ecotypes, Kerinci, Tapanuli, and Aceh. These are all on the island of Sumatra. If we look at the tree on the left, this looks very much like the samples of pines that we have here in the classroom. So the samples that I brought from the US look just like this. They have clear rings, the early wood, the late wood, the tracheid cells, everything that we discussed yesterday in terms of the wood anatomy. They seem to show a good sensitivity to climate. They're not complacent. They are different from year to year. Look at the one on the right. This is the same species in the same island. And there is no distinguishable ring formation at all. And then the one in the middle is curious also, because it seems to be truly in between these two. It does clearly have some bands, but they are not nearly as distinct as the ones on the left. It's a little hard to see on the projection. When you look at it closer in person, it's clear that like this whole area of this core is very fuzzy. Oh yeah, thank you. It might be good to turn down the lights. The rings are indistinct and blurring from one place to another. So this is one example to show you what that continuous growth looks like. I think it's a very interesting example because it's the same species in basically the same place. But there is more seasonality associated with the environment where this left-hand core comes from. And then this same species in Thailand and Vietnam farther to the north has been cross-dated successfully. So there are chronologies in the International Tree Ring Database from this species. So, interesting example. This is an example of some of the type of work that's going on now in many tropical areas to try to understand the anatomical features of different species of trees and learn whether or not they're useful for dendrochronology. And our colleagues here in Lucknow are also engaged in this kind of process here in India. So this is one of the topics that was brought up in the tropical dendroecology reading, and then it was brought up here in class yesterday as well, and we talked about this a little bit. The idea that putting some sort of a wound in the cambium at a known time, at a known date, allows us later on to go back and dissect the wood and see what happened to the cells at that time. One reason that that's useful in the tropics is that in the case that a tree does not form an annual ring, or if we are unsure whether the rings are annual or not, we can create a wound at a certain time, and then we know exactly how long it has been since the wound was created. So we can see how much wood growth occurred, and we can see whether or not any ring structures are actually annual rings. So this is the technique called pinning. P-I-N-N-I-N-G. And as I mentioned yesterday, it's one of the few things in science where it is what it sounds like. It's putting a pin into the tree. So the general topic is called cambia wounding, because that's the overall idea. And this is, I taught a dendrochronology class this semester, and one of the students made this presentation. It's just a short overview, and I thought it was relevant to this topic of cambia wounding that came up with the tropical dendroecology. So these are the questions that she asked about the efficacy of cambia wounding, what kinds of methods there are, and what are some of the weaknesses of these methods. So the concept is that some sort of cambial damage interrupts growth and causes abnormal cells to form. On the right-hand side, we are seeing a tree, not a pinned tree, but rather a tree that has experienced numerous fires. So that's a natural form of cambia wounding. And once we'll talk more about this use of tree rings with studying fire ecology next week. This is going to be one of our important topics. But briefly right now, what happens when the fire burns is that it leaves behind a scar. It killed cambial tissue out here where there is no longer anything left. And then it killed some of the cambial tissue inwards, but it did not kill the whole tree. So the tree began to grow back, grew back again, but then experienced another fire, and so on. So a long sequence of forest fires that scarred this tree. So as you can see from this example, the dates of the wounds on this tree go back to the earliest one is in the year 1783, down here at the bottom. So over 200 years ago, about 240 years ago almost. So these scars persist in the wound, and the scars are associated with the date of wounding. Anything that happens to the tree while it is growing and that affects the growth behavior of the rings is then recorded for as long as that wood persists. As long as the tree lives, but then even after the tree dies, if we still find the wood in a good state of condition, we can still date it.
What's the age of this tree then?
We don't know the age because the lowest date on the bottom of the picture there
yeah.
is 1783.
Okay.
And the tree was
1899.
Certainly somewhat older than that. So it's at least from the 1780s.
So,
yeah.
Okay. Centuries.
Many centuries, yeah. Okay, so we have this idea that wounds or any kind of injury that the tree receives can leave behind a scar, and wounds can be from natural causes. So we have the fire example. There are flood scars when trees that are growing in a river channel or a drainage where the water passes, say, on a mountain. Can be scarred because the flood carries with it rocks or logs that hit the tree and scar it. We can have damage from logging, damage from lightning, etc. Many kinds of wounds. And we can also have intentional wounds. And that's really the theme that we're investigating here. And that involves inserting a pin into, through the bark and to the cambium to wound the cambium at a known time. So this image is from a publication where what they're trying to show is pushing the pin forward into the tree. And the thing that is used could actually be like a sturdy pin, such as you would use for sewing, or it could be something stronger like a thin nail or something like that. It depends what's necessary to penetrate the bark and reach into the tree. But you don't want, you're not trying to hammer a nail deep into the tree. You're simply trying to penetrate the cambium and stop when you arrive at the xylem cells. So you penetrate the soft part and stop at the hard part. And this leaves behind abnormal cell formation around the wounded area of the tree. So we see these all look like softwoods. We see lots of tracheids. And then we see this abnormal growth, this hole left behind in the tree, and then these different ragged edges of the tree's tissues. There are different patterns that people have used for pinning, and oftentimes pinning occurs on multiple occasions. So this is an example of a pattern on the left for a single occasion. This was in 1981. The first publication on the used pinning came out in 1968. And then for a long time it was done on softwood trees, and then eventually someone tried it on some hardwood trees, and so now it's receiving a little bit broader use and is also expanding to tropical forests. But in this single occasion setting, the authors put in three pins where it says A, B, and C. And then on either side, these are control areas. These are unpinned areas, but when they finished the experiment, they went back to the tree and extracted the wood from all of those areas. So they went back and removed the left-hand wood for A. They removed the wood around the pinhole A, and they removed the right-hand wood as well. And the purpose of that was to trace the effect of the pinning and compare it to these control areas on either side to see what the normal ring development looked like. In this example, well, in both of these examples, the idea of the authors was to pin on multiple occasions. And this is a type of study where we're interested not only in knowing one date, but multiple dates across a whole growing season or a whole year. So this kind of a technique would allow us to, for instance, pin every month for a year and then begin to assemble a picture of the monthly growth of this tree across that whole year. Does that make sense? So we can see which cells are forming when. Some other methods
that it, excuse me. For example, that it gives a precision where you
extract the cores. Once you pin a tree, then the same from the same point or same spot, you have to extract the cores or.
What they extract is a bigger piece of wood.
Mm-hmm.
So much like what they're like, you see how it's a little square right there.
Yeah.
So they try to take a piece. It looks like about 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters.
Yeah.
It does not have to be as deep as a core.
Yeah.
It's a superficial piece of wood.
Yeah.
But they're trying to extract the entire square, and they did that with a hammer and chisel. So they chisel around the four sides of the square and then break the piece free to get the wood out.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So they're not trying to core directly over the pin spot because that would be hard.
Yeah.
Because if you use the larger size increment borer, that would work.
Yeah.
Something that I don't know if anyone has tried, but there are saws that cut in a circle,
mm-hmm.
and you could get a circular saw like that and cut a piece out. So some other methods that people have tried to use, I'm not familiar with all these methods, so I'm only going to talk about two of them. Well, I'll talk about three of them, the ones that I know. So the use of dendrometers. A dendrometer means that you stretch a band around the tree, and you like a wire. And this wire is attached to a very sensitive instrument that measures the movement of the wire. So as the tree grows, the dendrometer provides you with daily or even hourly measurements of the size of the diameter. Dendrometers have been used in many kinds of forest research. They are somewhat expensive because each instrument, you know, costs a reasonable amount of money. And dendrometers have some disadvantages when it comes to measuring the kind of growth that we are interested in talking about now. And when you first think about it, it almost might seem like the dendrometer would actually be the perfect instrument to measure, to answer this question. How much do trees grow radially? And including in the tropics, in a place where it may not be forming rings, so we're curious about its growth. What might be a disadvantage of a dendrometer or a limitation on its use? Does anyone have any experience with dendrometers?
If you would work in the Indian conditions, then the first thing is it would be disturbed or threatened by somebody.
Okay. That makes sense, yeah. You don't want to just leave your instrument wrapped around the tree. Okay. Anything else?
Dendrometer not told about the animal rings. It only told
the total growth.
Yeah,
that's
growth.
True. Yeah, that's absolutely true.
Mm-hmm.
So we are, when we dissect a block of wood that has been pinned, we actually see all the rows of cells.
Mm-hmm.
And as we discussed yesterday, each row of cell is formed from a cambial initial,
mm-hmm.
the cambium cells around the outside. So we can trace back, this cell was formed before this cell, like that. We trace the ancestry almost of each cell. We can't do that with a dendrometer. The other big problem with dendrometers is that sometimes trees shrink. They don't always grow. Why would they shrink?
Stress
of what?
Stress of water.
Yeah, so when under water stress, you have a change in size that is seasonal and sometimes even daily. So if you have a sensitive dendrometer, the dendrometer moves a lot like this. On average, eventually, if you leave it in place for a year, the tree will get bigger over time. But for many timescales, it's not that useful to track growth.
Mm-hmm.
But the
shrinkage must be a transient phenomenon.
It is, because once water comes in,
water
then it swells.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
But both the shrinking and the swelling are not fixed properties,
yeah.
because they're not really a property of the wood, they're a property of the hydrological status of each cell.
But obviously, dendrometer would require.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other one that I can talk about on this side is called microcoring. And this is simply coring. So this is taking an increment core, as we did in the field, but simply taking a very short core. Not with the intention of reaching the center of the tree, but simply capturing the last few years of the tree's growth. The reason one would do this is that, again, if we know the date of our sampling, then we can see how many cells have developed, or we can see our starting point for the first sample, then we can return, say, in 2 weeks, and take another microcore from the same tree next to it, and then come back 2 weeks later and take another microcore, and so on. And so we can watch the change in cell growth from sample to sample over the course of the season. And that's a reasonably effective way of doing these kinds of studies as well. So it's another, it's kind of in competition with pinning as a way of looking at tree growth. However, the microcoring is going to work best when the tree does form annual rings, because the ring gives you a point of reference from where you are first starting. Otherwise, it's kind of arbitrary that you don't know where your starting point was. But if the tree has a ring, then you start measurement after the last ring, and then 2 weeks later you can see how much it's grown since that last ring, and so on. On the seedlings and sapling side, the practice of tilting is kind of an innovative way of saying when wood formation changed. What do you think tilting means? Tilting, right? It just means taking like a plant that's in a pot, a nursery plant, and tilting it at an angle. What will the tree try to do when it tilts? It'll start to form reaction wood, and it will attempt to correct its growth and begin to grow upwards. So if we're interested in knowing when cells form, one way of doing that would be to take some small seedlings in pots, tilt them, and come back, dissect some of them perhaps in 6 months, in 12 months, in 18 months, and we can see where this reaction wood starts to form, and we can relate that to the date of the tilting event. Yeah. It's not going to be as perfect a relationship, but it's still helpful in figuring out when how long the wood has been in that situation. So these are kind of interesting methods that people are using to try to measure growth. So the pinning method is relatively non-destructive. I say relatively because when you sample the pieces, when you take the pieces back out of the tree, then that is destructive. And sometimes they cut the tree down. But at the time that the pinning is done, it's non-destructive. And it doesn't affect the physiology of the tree. It doesn't leave really an open wound. It's a very tiny injury to the tree. It's precise. It allows you to distinguish between these transient periods of shrinking and swelling of the tree, as we discussed with the dendrometer, versus actual cambial growth. And it's a very simple method and applicable across many species, many ages. One of you brought up a question yesterday or the day before about a tropical forest and how one might study, might develop chronologies and so on in a situation where forest had dozens or hundreds of species. And that's very difficult to do. Yeah. But this, for example, is a type of study that could be done across multiple species.
Yeah. And if you will visit sometime in Nainital or Almora, next week or next week, you will see many pine trees, twisted pine, tilted, not tilted. They are twisted, twisted at 45 degrees, as big as that. And there is a whole division there, called twisted pine division. Have you seen that? That would be a very good, interesting.
What is the reason for the twist?
Nobody knows.
Okay, well, we're going to go there in 2 weeks, so we'll
They twist in a particular direction. I have forgotten whether it is a dextrous or something different, but
So many trees have a spiral grain.
Yeah.
So their growth spirals around the tree.
But at a particular point, I think below CBH.
Could it be CBH, the snow?
Yeah, 30, 40 centimeters above ground. It takes a twist and then became a straight. But because without any reason. Nobody knows that.
We have some trees that appear similar to what you're describing,
yeah.
where I live.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's caused by snow. When they were very young,
yeah.
the snow pushed them down,
yeah.
and then they can't stand up, but then they start to grow.
Yeah, yeah. Here, many people ascribe that because of edaphic factors. They are growing
the
on micaceous, mica.
Hmm.
Phyllite and mica. Mica dominated
mm-hmm.
rocks. And but thereafter, I haven't heard anything.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is only conjectures. But you may see them, some of them. Yeah.
The
whole division established for that, managing that twisted pine division.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, we'll look for that. Okay. These graphs are a little bit hard to interpret, and I don't want to spend too much time on it. But this is a study where McKinnon and others compared the use of pinning microcoring in dendrometers. And they showed some differences in that the dendrometers picked up growth earlier in the season, but the dendrometers also had more negative growth. And negative growth means shrinking of the trees, and that is really due to the water stress rather than the cell growth, because the cells, once they have their mature cell walls, they cannot shrink. Some potential weaknesses of the pinning method. It requires one to make decisions that may be subjective about what cells are abnormal, about locating the exact point where the pinning occurred inside the tree. That can be quite time consuming to dissect each little block of wood and make a thin slice of it that you can see through the microscope. There are differences between species such that while it is true that pinning can be applied to multiple species, each species has its own unique anatomical features. So the practitioner needs to learn all of those features so that they can understand what is happening in the wood. And then the last point is that even if you pick a pattern of pinning where you're trying to capture a large area or go all the way around the tree, there is still variation in the growth. And so it may be the case that, you know, you're not completely capturing or completely representing all of the growth of the tree with the pins that you've selected. But it's an interesting method and one that has a lot of applicability in the tropics. So I wanted to talk about it a little bit more. Okay. All right. So let's move on and move into our main topic for today, which is development of chronologies. So we have talked about chronologies, and we looked at an example with the skeleton plotting exercise, but we haven't gotten into detail about what a chronology really is. This is the example that we looked at from the skeleton plotting exercise. So you recall that the upper part of the graph paper, these are the lines that we drew ourselves. And on the lower part, this is the result from the master chronology. So up here on this portion of the graph, right in the middle, this is the part that we moved back and forth to match up with ours, right? And so you see that there are some lines that are drawn downwards that are quite long, and those are the marker years for that tree. Now, if we follow those lines down to the lower part of the graph paper, we see that they correspond with the low points on this continuous graph. So here, for instance, we have a low point in the graph, and that's where this deep line was drawn. Does everybody see that? So what the graph, what the continuous graph is representing is a compiled standardized average tree growth of many trees. And that's what a master chronology is. This is not one single tree's growth. This is the combined average of many trees from the site. All
trees
of these
the species?
Of the same species,
of
almost
the same
always.
Species, so, yeah.
Almost always the
okay,
same species, yeah.
Yeah.
So if this is a chronology of Pinus roxburghii, then at the top we have one single sample that we are trying to date, and at the bottom we have a master chronology of Pinus roxburghii, where this line is representing that average growth. And the line, you can see, it goes up and down quite a bit. So notice that first of all, very zigzaggy. So we have high growth, pretty high growth, low growth, somewhat low growth, very low growth, high growth again. You know, quick changes from year to year. So this is a fairly sensitive change. We can also notice that it's fairly symmetrical around the central line. So the central line is this dark black line, and the amount of down is about the same as the amount of up. And that's because this line has been standardized. It's been made such that it has an average that goes around that black line, and it has equal variance from beginning to end. The chronology is much longer than what's shown here, of course. This is only about 55 years or so on this image. The chronology can be perhaps 200, 300 or more years long. But it's quite standardized. So it oscillates around this mean, and it has similar size of peaks and valleys across its entire extent. And then for the purposes of the skeleton plotting, these years of very low growth are the years that are marked with these dark lines, and thus that lets us match that pattern up to an individual sample that also had narrow rings in those particular years. So this is the connection between the skeleton plot that we created ourselves and what the master chronology is. So now we're going to talk about how we get the master chronology, how we create a master chronology. So we're interested in having one in the first place because, as you can see in this example, it helps us cross-date tree samples. So when we get new samples, we can match patterns on our new samples with the master chronology and thus say that our new samples are in fact cross-dated. A related kind of a point, if you think about it, the examples that we did for the skeleton plot, they were all 60 years long, unless you guys change the parameters in the skeleton plotting exercise, but the default side length is 60 years. And in almost no cases did they come up to the present. Like a lot of the starting dates were in the 1870s or the 1700s, they were a long time ago. So by having a master chronology, it allows us to take a piece of wood that is floating in time. We don't have any sort of clue where to begin thinking about what date is the end date, and allows us to match that pattern. So that's very useful. Okay, so there are two ways that a master chronology can be constructed. The first way is something called a composite skeleton plot. And this is something that is conceptually related to the skeleton plot that we created. Let's say that we had many individual samples and we mark all of the marker years on our samples, and we find that we can go from one sample to another. We don't yet have a master chronology, but we find that we can match from one sample to another. So we could take all of these samples on paper, lay them out on a table in front of us, put one piece of graph paper at the very bottom, and visually say, okay, the year 1961 has been a marker in every single sample. It's a very strong year, so I'm going to make a deep mark on my master chronology with my skeleton plot. So we can take all of our individual skeleton plots and turn them into a single master. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's just conceptually carrying the information from tree to tree to tree and then averaging it together. And thus, if we found another year, let's say 1976, that is a strong marker year on some of the samples but not on others, then on the master we might not mark it, or we might give it a very small mark because it's not as reliable of a marker year. This is reminding me that I brought something else that I want to pass around. This is the real-life version of the graph paper that we were looking at on the screen. This is a way to make skeleton plots, is to purchase this kind of paper. There's one square per centimeter with it's a 5x5 square in each centimeter. And you cut it into strips like this. And you take a pencil and you write the 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, just like we see on the computer version. And you can begin to carry out skeleton plotting. One of the interesting things about dendrochronology is that it, in some ways, is a very economical branch of science. There is a lot that one can do. You need a microscope, but not a super microscope. These are microscopes that you find in biology labs and classrooms. And with some graph paper and a pencil and an increment border, you can do a lot. You know, everything doesn't have to be highly expensive. Now I'm going to pass these around, and I'm also going to pass around, this is an example of a chronology drawn out on a piece of graph paper. And so just like the one on the screen, the lines are at the top because this is the chronology. And if I had an individual sample, I would make the lines going down to the bottom, and that way they line up and I can look at them. Pass around some of the paper. Give people an idea. All right. So that first methodology, then, this was the original way in which people began to create master chronologies. But there is a lot of information that is being lost when we do a composite skeleton plot. For example, if we look at the graphical example of the master chronology here, we have years from 1800 to 1850. So every sample in every year has a ring width, right? But we have not captured any of that information. All we've captured is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So 14 out of those 50 years we have selected to mark on the skeleton plot because they're particularly narrow. But that means we're overlooking, we're not using a lot of information. So beginning a long time ago, people began to take tree ring measurements to actually measure the width of individual rings and then record that information mathematically so that we could have all the numbers, all the values of the ring widths. Beyond simply measuring the whole ring, there is also a line. There are many people who measure the early wood and the late wood separately. So they are collecting two measurements per ring, the width of the early wood and the width of the late wood. And those measurements can be useful because we discussed a little bit yesterday in talking about the anatomy, that under certain circumstances, the late wood may change in its formation. Like we had the example of an early frost, which could stop the growth of the late wood in a certain year. If we measure early wood and late wood separately, we can pick that up. Another application in my region has to do with the strength of the monsoon rains, because a lot of times the late wood forms under the influence of those rains. And so people are trying to use late wood width as a correlate to reconstruct past patterns of the monsoon, which is an interesting and very useful project. Okay. So as we discussed before, we have the situation with measurements that within a given tree, we have the age-related growth decline. Roots tend to be bigger when the tree is younger. And then from one tree to another tree, we may have completely different ringwidths in absolute terms. So even though a particular marker year may be relatively narrow on a certain tree, like here's an example right here on this tree up here at the right. That ring is pretty narrow, right there. And the ring before it, assuming it's a real ring, I'm not sure, but I think it is. So let's say there's two rings here that are quite narrow. But on the other hand, in absolute measurements, in millimeters, those rings are not that different from the average rings right here on this other tree. So one of the very first problems with the fact that tree rings are different in size from one tree to another, or from one place to another in the same tree, is that if we try to average these numbers together, the big numbers wash out the effect of the smaller numbers. If we have a few samples with very large rings, then they're going to have much more influence on the mathematical average than a number of samples with smaller rings.
Yeah, of course.
So that's where the idea of standardization becomes important. So we talked about this on the first day, the idea of signal and noise. And in the case of a lot of the focus of tree ring research for cross-dating and for many applications of dendroclimatology, the important part is trying to isolate the part of the signal caused by climatic fluctuation. The climate is the regional factor that coordinates tree growth, that synchronizes the occurrence of particularly narrow rings, but also potentially large rings as well. And so isolating that part of the variability is really important for cross-dating. In fact, you could say that the skeleton plot is really just distilling this climatic information, this tree-to-tree signal, because we're trying to match these patterns. On the other hand, and we'll talk more about this next week, for people who are studying other things like disturbances, fire, herbivory, the effect of forest management treatments, the effect of fertilization, those kinds of things may require trying to get rid of the climate signal so that you can look at the effect of the other thing that you're trying to study. So here's the answer, so to speak, one of the answers for how to carry this out. So this is the dissertation of Edward Cook. And if you work in dendroclimatology very long, you will find many important publications by Cook, or Cook and others. Cook, I'm not expecting you to read this this abstract here, or the statement of the problem, but Cook has been one of the principal people who has formalized a lot of the ways in which we standardize chronologies today. And then he's applied that particularly in dendroclimatology. So he has constructed gridded networks of many important variables related to climatic fluctuations from tree rings. For example, the Palmer Drought Severity Index. Is this index commonly used in India as well? PDSI? Okay. Is anyone familiar with it?
Do you know what it is?
In one of the thesis on the PDSI, the dot severity index, -2+1. We have heard about it.
Okay.
But through only one papers.
What is a drought index? I mean, it's a measurement of drought, right? But if we call something an index, does that bring anything to mind? We give a numerical value, and also it's a value that comes from multiple variables. It's not only one single variable. It's not just average precipitation, because average precipitation is average precipitation. It's measured in millimeters. So an index doesn't have units because it is combined of many different values. And a drought index, there are many kinds of drought indices in the world, and they will combine things like current year precipitation, perhaps the previous winter precipitation, perhaps the amount of moisture that the soil can hold, and the amount of runoff. So it's trying to balance moisture coming in, moisture going out, and when that balance becomes very negative, then we are in drought. So Palmer Drought Severity Index is one of many indices like this. I'm sure there are others that are used commonly here. And Cook is one of the people who has developed gridded indices of drought for all of North America, for instance. Another contribution has been, well, not by Cook, but by other people doing similar work, has been to make gridded indices of the effects of El Nino and La Nina events. So the southern oscillation effects are captured from tree rings. Okay, so now we're going to look in a little bit of detail at ways of trying to carry out the standardization of tree ring information so that we can incorporate these tree rings, these measured tree rings, into an average series, into a chronology. So we looked at this graphic also on the first day, and this is an example of data from measuring tree rings beginning around the year 1600 on a particular core and coming up through the late 1800s, so about 270 years or so of information on this core. And we see that the tree rings vary. There are sharp oscillations going up and down. So these oscillations are probably due to differences in climate from one year to another. The measurements of a tree ring are in actual millimeters, so they're in absolute measurements. They're not relative, they're absolute. So if I had another tree and the tree rings on that other tree were twice as big, then I would plot that tree and it would be up here on this same graph. And that's why it's a problem to average them together, because the bigger tree is going to have more influence than the smaller tree rings. So
nevertheless, it's an asymptote kind of a...
Excuse me?
Asymptote curve, huh?
The,
over the years.
The black curve?
Yeah, no, the red line.
So the red line is a smooth line that is fit through here. It's a function. Yeah. But let's just look at the black line for a minute. So the black line is going up and down quite a bit. That's the influence of climate. Let us say that for our present purposes, our biggest interest right now is to isolate the effect of climate, and specifically the year-to-year effect of climate. Wet year, dry year, wet year, that kind of influence. Right now, we're not interested in long-term climate changes like the Atlantic multi-decadal oscillation. Let's set that aside. We just want to see the effect of climate. So we can see that from the ups and downs here. And we can capture that on a skeleton plot. We could take this year, for instance, right here, which is the year 1670, and we can make a deep line on a skeleton plot. But if we're trying to work with the measurements, then we have to think about how to try to standardize them, because this year is also a deep line, but that year is way higher, much higher value of absolute measurements than this year. This year would probably be a notable line relative to what's around it, but it's a much higher measurement as well. And then we have this whole age-related growth trend problem back in here. So one way of trying to find a standardization is to fit a curve through the middle of the data and then capture the differences from that fitted line. So that's what the red line is. And the red line in this case is a negative exponential curve. This kind of graphic and this text font and everything, we'll see a number of examples of that in this presentation. They all come from a program called RSTAN, A-R-S-T-A-N. And that's one of the programs in the Dendrochronology Program Library, or DPL, that is available on online and available free for everyone to use. Dendrochronological Program program library. So DPL. If you use the R, if you use R statistical computing, then there's a package called DPLR. And you can use that package to access most of these features as well. Tomorrow we're going to use another program from the Dendro program library called Cofecha. And Cofecha also creates standardized chronologies, and Cofecha provides us with a means of assessing the quality of our cross-dating. It's a very interesting program, it's very fundamental to dendrochronology, and we're going to do it interactively here on the computer so that we'll see it run. I hope. I think it's going to run on this computer. We'll find out. Okay. So, everybody, I think, understands the problem. We measure the tree rings in absolute measurements. Now we are fully using the information from the tree, unlike the skeleton plot that was only using some of the information. But we have this problem of that it's not homogeneous. Some places there are bigger values and smaller. So let's fit a line to it, like this red line, and try to remove that that divergence. So the purpose of, or the method of standardization is an attempt to fit a line through the data, thereby removing the age-related trend, which we see here at the beginning of this sample, and result in a dimensionless index. There are two different ways we'll see in a minute to do standardization. In this case, the mean equals 1. In another way of doing it, the mean can equal 0, and the value is going to be positive and negative. But here at the bottom, you can see we've gone from measurements on this y-axis to indices here. This is no longer in millimeters, this is now an index. And the beauty and the value of doing this is if I take a tree with big rings and convert it to index, and I take a tree with small rings and convert it to index, now I can average the indexes. Now I can combine them in one chronology, and everything is fair, nothing is biasing one tree, biasing the effect of another in terms of its response to climate. So what we are seeing in the bottom graph, imagine the red line in the top graph. Imagine that you take that line between your fingers, it's a curved line, and you pull it straight. That now is the black line on the lower graph. The lower graph and the upper graph is the same set of tree ring data, but this flat black line in the middle is the former red line on top. And the new red line down here is a moving average of what's left behind after we've accomplished this standardization process. So one of the first things that you'll notice is that at the top of the page it says we've created a dimensionless index, yes. Mean equals 1, yes. We can see the black line with the mean equals 1. And homoscedastic variance, which means equivalent or equal or homogeneous variance. No. Not really, right? Because look at this plot spot right in here. Right. Here we have, in the original tree, a period of very good growth, and that is still present right here. And here we had, in the original tree, an extended period of a few decades of quite low growth, and that is still present right here. So we have, in fact, carried out this standardization process, but we don't have a perfect solution. So if we back up for a second and think about how we did it, we fit this red line, it's a negative exponential curve. So negative exponential just means it's declining and then it flattens out. That's what that function does. And so that's helpful because it helps us remove the age-related growth trend. It creates a curve that, in general, looks like the shape that we expect to see in a tree. Bigger rings in the middle, and then gradually becoming smaller over time. Unfortunately, in real life, this tree also had other periods of reduced growth and increased growth, and thus, we did not completely remove all of those effects. Does that make sense to everybody? You can see that happening? not only is it the case that that happened, but if we're going to use a smooth function like this, there's no way around it. Anything that deviates from the performance of the smooth function that we pick is naturally going to carry that behavior on into the standardized core, into the ring width indices of that core. So, is there anything we could have done differently that would have not resulted in these kind of funny bulges in the final answer?
We measure the ring width with the help of Lemaitre. Like this type of graph appear on the computer.
If you have the LimTab system, yes.
So we call it ring width. But in the blue graph, we call it indices. When we call it ring width or indices.
Okay. So when the measurements are originally taken, when you're using the instrument, we're going to look at the instruments a little bit later this morning. When you're using the instrument to measure the ring width, then those measurements are made in millimeters. And these measuring devices are very nice. They're very precise. So they measure to 1/1000th of a millimeter, a micron. And so those measurements are in millimeters, and that's what we're seeing at the top of the screen. The indices is once we have fit a function to the raw measurements and then convert it to an index. And I'll show you in a minute the math to do the conversion. Because I don't know if this is moving too slow or too fast, but I'm trying to find a way in between for everybody so that we can walk along. Because this is not really that complicated, but sometimes it sounds like it is. So if people say, well, I standardized and then I pre-whitened and carried out autoregression, it sounds very intimidating. But it's actually, you know, it's everybody can see how it happens. You just have to go through it one step at a time. So here we have indices on the bar.
And what is the independent variable? Is this precipitation or drought years?
Independent variable.
Yeah.
Along the bottom,
yes,
this is the value in each year.
Drought.
So in the year 1700, no, let's look up here. In the year 1700, the ring width of the core was 0.15, looks like, millimeters.
Yes.
In the year 1700. In the year 1701, it looks like it was a little bit less. In 1702, a little bit less.
Right.
So these are the actual calendar years of the dated core.
Yeah.
And the value on the y-axis is how wide the rings are.
Yeah, that's okay. Fine. But what is causing that narrowing in the rings and that independent variable is precipitation, drought year.
That's probably the most important.
Superimpose that data, that in variable independent variable data, whether that the data match with this graph, the width of the rings.
So when we, yes, it's probably climate.
Yeah.
So remember when we talked about that principle of aggregate tree ring development?
Yeah.
We said that the width of a tree ring in that equation that we looked at is related to various variables, and one of those variables was the climate, the year of formation of the tree ring.
Okay.
And so from one year to another, that's probably what makes the biggest difference. This year was very good, this year was very bad. But when we see a big period of good growth, it could be because all of a sudden for 40 years, the climate was much more favorable.
Variation in weather or variation in climate means the longer period may show the variation in climate, but when it is going zigzag, then it is obviously a variation in weather, weather conditions.
Or annual scale.
Annual scale, yeah, weather variation.
And then at the, when we see big dips and big increases, possibly that's a longer term climatic
oscillation. Have temporal dimension, then we can say that certain thing is there in the climate.
Yeah.
Yeah, for that particular period of time.
Potentially, yeah.
Yeah, potentially. Yeah.
We have to verify that by seeing how it correlates with instrumental
yes,
weather.
Yes,
data
yes,
from yes, weather. Yes, yes. Okay. So the last point on here before we leave this slide, you understand how the fact that we fit this function, the function is flat through here. It just has to be because it's the math that makes that function. It can't decide to go some other direction. It has to be flat. If we fit a different function somehow, a function that could move like this wiggly red line, then we could have maybe dipped down in here and we could have gone up over there. So part of the work of the dendrochronologist is actually deciding when you do the standardization, do I want to use simply a unique function for every single core, the same function that forces it to use the same treatment of mathematically of standardizing it? Or would I want to use something more flexible like this? We'll come back to that in a minute, but here you can see the utility
yeah.
of the flexibility.
Yeah, flexibility, yeah. But then we can say that the climate is getting all the more, how can we interpret this graph then? From 1600 to 1850, that it is putting constraint on the tree growth. In that way, we can interpret this graph.
Well, so that's a good question. Let's think about that. So once we've converted it to indices, now the average growth is around 1. So the average growth fits perfectly through the middle. But in the first 100 years, it goes back and forth around the middle, then there's a dip, then there's a big hill, and then there's another dip, right? So
yeah.
it's more erratic.
Yeah.
So what could be the reason for that?
Maybe more frequent drought years.
So there could be a climatic factor that operates at a scale of, say, 30 or 40 years that produces a big dip and then produces a big increase. That's possible.
Yeah.
What else could do that? Possibly a fire, like say if a fire burned on this and affected this tree around here, and then really damaged it. So it killed, you know, half of the canopy, and it took decades to grow back and start being productive again, maybe. What about a big increase in growth? What might cause that? Besides climate, we already
yeah,
said.
High precipitism.
Excuse me?
High precipitism.
Besides climate, what else can make a tree grow?
Yeah,
so if its neighbors die, right? So another fire or insects or something kill off its biggest competitor, and all of a sudden for quite a few decades this tree can grow really well. Now, you can see that there are multiple possibilities. What's the first thing that comes to mind? How can we figure out which one is right? How could we test which of these many possibilities might be right?
We'll have to get all those data if we have availability that we can superimpose it with these growth plots and then we can find it.
So if we had climate data, for instance, then we could, if we had a weather station that was recording temperature and precipitation. Unfortunately, in most of the world, we don't really have that for the year 1700, 1750.
We also digit the history of that particular site, like the drought occurs in 1780s, that type of situation. So we easily correlate the growth of tree ring at that duration. Like 1750s, growth is very less, or that duration drought also occurs. So we the region may be the drought at that period.
So that is something we can do as well. For example, in Mexico, Mexican history, and it's probably similar in India, there are recorded enormous droughts. So in the early 1800s, there is a famous year called the Year of Hunger, because nationally it was a terrible drought, and many people suffered, and some people died. And it turns out that that year absolutely shows up in the tree ring record. So comparison to records is a good way of doing of trying to resolve what caused what. There's yet another way. If this is one tree, the So we're still just looking at one tree here. One of the possibilities we said was competition, right? Mm-hmm. How could I maybe tell whether competition was the factor versus climate? How about if I core another tree? How about if I core 20 trees or 30 trees? If all of the trees show this same pattern, then I think, well, this is something that happened to everybody. This is probably climate. If only this tree shows this pattern, then I think, well, it's probably not climate, it's the uniqueness of this tree. So we have a lot of ways of figuring out and puzzling out what's going on. All right, let's move forward, and we'll go a few more minutes, and then I think I hear the tea starting to be set up. Okay, this is a different tree. One that shows a really extraordinary bump in the early 1900s. And this particular study site, there actually was a quite wet period in here for about two or three decades. And so this may be truly a climate-caused phenomenon. This is another type of curve that is used. We're going to talk in a minute. I'll show you some more detailed examples of some of the functions that for detrending, but it's similar to the example we just looked at. There's the age trend, and there is, in this case, in the early 1900s, a big pulse of growth. And in this particular case, we think that this one was related more to climate. But we're still just looking at one tree right here. And we still have measurements on the top and indices on the bottom. Okay, so let's continue with the assumption that I brought up earlier. Let's say for the moment that we're most interested in finding that climate signal, picking out that year-to-year variability, the zigzag. I don't know what the term was that you used, jig-jag?
Oscillations.
The jig-jag, the abrupt oscillation. That's the year-to-year climate signal. That's what helps us cross-state and match up patterns. So let's keep going that way. Later on, we'll talk about all the other reasons why we might not want to do that. But now this is what we want to do. So we want to exclude ecological signals. So if we have individual trees that show a lot of effects of other things, if they're trees that are leaning, if we see big scars on them, if they're obviously suppressed underneath much bigger trees, then we're probably going to avoid those ecological signals. We would look for trees that have climatic sensitivity. So things like the slopes that we talked about the other day, the rocky soil, shallow soil, southern exposure in the northern hemisphere, or northern exposure in the southern hemisphere to be subject to more water stress and so on. So let's get rid of everything weird. We're probably not going to sample fire scarred trees to make a chronology. We're going to sample ones that seem to be growing mostly based on climate and not based on other ecological factors. The next thing that we want to do is remove the age and size trend. And the where it says here, and oops, I'm sorry. Where it says here an empirical approach is needed, that's the example of fitting a mathematical function of some sort to the tree ring data. There is a point made in the first bullet item here. If all disturbance is excluded and all pith dates are known, we can use a regional growth curve. This is a different kind of an approach. This is an approach that says that we know that pine trees in this region grow this fast when they're 0 to 10 years old, and then the rings are this big from 10 to 20 and 30 to 40 and so on. That's something that never happens in real life, at least with any of the trees that I work with, so it's not something that I use. But potentially, if you're in a very intensively managed forest situation, like a tree plantation, there may be detailed data about growth that you can apply to growth curves. The last point here is that when we when we focus on climatic signals that vary from year to year, we're kind of removing everything else. We're removing ecology, we're removing disturbance, and we're also even removing information that varies over longer periods of time. Yeah?
What about the disturbances that have been caused due to the change in climate?
Due to recent change in climate,
yeah.
When you say the disturbances,
also,
you mean...
It would also affect the competition. Suppose there is a drought here, the seedling, sapling, or the recent tree might die. Mm-hmm. Due to the change in climate. So ultimately both three are interlinked.
Mm-hmm.
So the removing a particular signal, considering that the other it has a noise, don't you think it will?
I would answer that with 3 points. The first point is that most of the time when we're working with tree ring information, especially to make a chronology like this, we're looking at information over many centuries. So most of the time period that is involved is in the past and in the fairly distant past. So things that are associated with changes in very recent decades are not going to have such a big impact on the chronology as a whole. The second point is that, you remember one of the other principles we mentioned on Monday was uniformitarianism? Does someone recall what the basic idea was there?
The
present is the key to the past. But the present is changing rapidly. And it's changing in some very unusual ways. So for example, as carbon dioxide levels build in the atmosphere, we of course see changes in climate. But we also have a direct effect of the carbon dioxide, because carbon dioxide is a necessary nutrient for plant growth. And at least in some species, because there's more carbon dioxide in the air, when a plant has its stomates open and takes in air from the atmosphere, it has more carbon dioxide in that air. That means it can close the stomates under drought and continue to photosynthesize a little bit longer than it could have 40 years ago. Because when it closes the stomate inside the leaf, there's more carbon dioxide than there was there 40 years ago. And so the water use efficiency of some plants is increasing. And this is really remarkable. And this is something that is a challenge to the uniformitarianism principle. The way that a tree responds to temperature today may actually not be the same as it was 100 years ago for the same species of tree in the same spot at the same temperature level. That difference is called divergence in dendrochronology. And it's a topic that we're going to talk about next week. It's a really interesting topic, and one that increasingly, I mean, everything about climate change affects everything that we do with ecology and management and conservation and so on. So it's just one more example of climate change's effects. But the divergence phenomenon in terms of dendrochronology is a very interesting thing to talk about. And we'll do that next week. There's a paper that I think it would be of interest for us to read. It's quite short on the divergence issue. And it's one that sort of captures people's imagination. So maybe we'll do that next week.
But some disturbance is caused by some type of the disaster, like a landslide,
mm-hmm.
sometimes the drought, sometimes the flood.
Sure.
So that will be the effect on the tree rings.
So every tree in nature is exposed to a variety of disturbances. All I'm saying right now is, for the purpose of making a chronology, we're trying to find trees, individuals in the forest, that are most affected by climate, and that are at least not obviously very affected by disturbance. Okay? But it is, yes, every tree is affected by various ecological factors, and we're not going to be able to find out what all of them are.
My apprehensions revolves around the signal and the noise, the terminology that we have used. Suppose we want to determine the climatic signal. That would be a signal for us.
Mm-hmm.
Other things that like disturbance and anthropogenic influence, that will be a noise for us. But suppose we are considering the climatic signals, the ENSO years, the El Nino Southern Oscillation, that stretches for 7 to 8 years in Indian context I'm talking about. But during that year, the regeneration of the tree, the sapling and seedling will be very less. And the tree that has already gone will respond in a very narrow tearing width. But when the El Nino years abolishes, or the effect of that year abolishes, so whatever the water will be available, so the tree already in the dead place will respond more fastly compared to the tree that will regenerate or younger trees. So how will you separate or segregate that disturbances, regeneration, or noise? So that is a problem for, I think.
So you're right. And you were right also. I'm not disagreeing that yes, trees are affected by all of these factors. So every tree in the growth that it puts on every year is an aggregate of various factors, including the climate of that year, the temperature, the precipitation, in fact, even more detailed, the temperature of each day, the precipitation, its distribution within the year, and so on. As well as whether or not there's an El Nino event at that time, whether or not there's a windstorm, if insects are eating it, etc. All of those things are affecting every tree every year. There's no such, if we had perfect information about the past climate, we would not have to try to infer it from tree rings, we would just look at the perfect information about the past climate. So all we're trying to do at the moment is as much as we can isolate the climatic signal. And the way that we do that is by excluding trees that obviously have a lot of other things going on, that obviously have had fires scarring them, floods hitting them, and so on. And that's what we're trying to do today to build a chronology. By next week, we're going to switch this picture completely and try to get rid of the climate part so that we can focus on the ecological effects of disturbances. Okay? So I ask you guys to, I recognize these points and just ask you to bear with me. Let's get through the chronology development and then we'll move into the ecological applications. But I think right now we should stop and take tea. Discussion of chronology development, and then we're going to mount our cores that have been collected on Tuesday. So I want to keep moving forward so that we have time for all of this. When we left off, we were commenting that for the moment our goal is to try to isolate this year-to-year climatic signal. This graphic is an illustration of some of the climatic signals that are much longer than 1 year at a time. These are three important oscillations that are felt around large parts of the world, and I think here in India as well. The first one is the El Nino Southern Oscillation. Then we have the PDO, which is Pacific Decadal Oscillation. And then the AMO, Atlantic Multi-Decadal Oscillation. So sometimes if you are not familiar with these things, they sort of all look the same. But they all end in O because that's oscillation. And then the D and the M, Pacific Decadal, if we look at the actual changes, we see that it goes, we have a period here of positive, a period of negative, a period of positive, a period of negative. That actually is on the order of a decade and a half. And then the Atlantic Multi-Decadal Oscillation. Look at this long period, several decades of positive values here, a dip, kind of nothing much happening there, long negative period there, relatively long positive there. So you can actually see the D and the M, the decadal and multi-decadal patterns differ. And then ENSO lasts somewhere from maybe as short as 2 or 3 years to as long as 5 to 7 years. And so it's at the same scale of these other oscillations, it's moving much more quickly. So these are all important parts of climate, but these are parts that we're setting aside for the moment because we want to focus on year-to-year climatic variation. Okay, so standardization. So standardization brings the ring width curves to the uniform value so that when we average them together, we are not having an unbalanced or unfair influence of certain series. The series that have big rings in absolute terms are not going to wash out the influence of the series that have small rings in absolute terms. So that's one of the main reasons why we have to have standardization. And in fact, it's often the case that the slow-growing trees are the ones that are actually most sensitive to climate. So we would not want their information to be lost or overwhelmed by the fast-growing trees. And when we standardize, we are converting the series to the same relative variance, the movement above and below the mean or around the mean. And so that also helps them have the same weight when they're averaged together. It keeps one series from dominating the whole chronology. So we want to do standardization. Yeah?
There was a line in the previous slide. Low-growing trees often have more climatic information. Mm-hmm. Why is it?
Do you recall what we said when we were picking trees that might be growing on a steep slope in a rocky soil and so on? Why did we want trees like that? Why did we think they were good for chronology? They're more under stress, right? So they're very sensitive to climate. Similarly, so they're sensitive to climate, and do you think that they tend to grow fast or slow? They grow slowly for that very reason, because they're under a lot of stress, and that's why they're so sensitive. So the two things are related, and that's why slow-growing trees are often going to have a lot of climatic information. Okay, so this is the... Now we're going to look at the math of two ways of standardization. And the first one is called standardization by ratio. So this creates an index value, I sub t. So the t refers to whatever year you're in. So if we're in the year 1600, the index value for the year 1600 is the raw ring width, the actual measured ring width in the year 1600, divided by the estimated growth curve, which is the red line, the function that we have fit through our data. So we fit this function, the red line, the same tree that we looked at the beginning of this presentation. And in the year 1600, the estimated growth is where the red line is. The actual growth is way down here. So if I divide the actual growth R divided by the estimated growth G, the red one, then my answer is going to be something like 0.5, maybe 0.45, maybe a little bit less than 0.5. Let's look at another year. Let's look at the year, this looks like maybe it's about 1603. The red line and the black line are at the same value. So if I divide one number by the other number and they're both the same value, what's the answer going to be? 1. So the standardization, whenever the estimated growth and the actual growth are the same, it's 1. When the actual growth is less, it's going to be a decimal, a fraction less than 1, like 0.5 or 0.2. And when it's more, then it'll be a number greater than 1, like perhaps 1.8 or something like that, looks like is what this value was. So that is standardization by ratio. And when we're done with doing that, because the red line runs pretty much through the middle of the black curve, the overall average is going to be 1. The other kind of standardization is called standardization by difference. And in this case, we are taking the difference between the estimated growth curve and the actual measurement. So we take this value minus that value. Excuse me, we take the raw value minus that value. That value is bigger, so if we take a small number and subtract a bigger number, we get a negative number. On the other hand, when we look at a different year, like this year over here, this year is bigger than the growth curve, so if we take this minus this, we get a positive number. So if we do that with all of our values, all of our ring width measurements, then we end up with a standardized data set where the mean equals 0. So these are our two most common choices. We can do by ratio or by difference. You will see that in the sort of typical way that we use this, the most common way is with standardization by ratio. Okay. So in order to do this, we have to fit the curve, and we already talked about the negative exponential curve. It's a function, so it has a smooth line determined by a negative exponential function. It's just the math of that function. So we have to decide how to do that. And we basically have two kinds of curves that we can use for standardization. We can use a deterministic model. A deterministic model is kind of a fancy way of saying that ahead of time, without looking at the data, we're just going to say, we plan to use a function like this, such as a negative exponential function. We would do this for a kind of theoretical reason. The theoretical reason is that the negative exponential starts high and then it gradually tapers off to a flat or asymptotically declining curve. And theoretically, that's what the age-related growth trend of the tree should look like. So we could decide ahead of time we're going to fit a model that theoretically fits the way a tree should grow. So the other choice is to not do that, and instead, look at the data or let the variation in the data guide the curve that's used for standardization, the growth curve. And that's called a stochastic or empirical way of doing it. And the example of, the key example of a method like this is the cubic spline. A spline curve is a type of moving average that can adjust itself to the variation in the data set. So deterministic functions have been used a lot, and so Fritz is, Professor Joshi sent me a paper by Fritz, and he said it looks like a classic, and he was right because Fritz is a classic author in dendrochronology. For many years, he was the director of the Tree Ring Laboratory, and he wrote a book called Tree Rings and Climate. It was published in 1976, I think, and then went out of print, but then it was brought back by a publishing house because it's such a useful book, so especially for dendroclimatology. And so Fritz says that there might be reasons to use a deterministic function because theoretically, it just seems very reasonable. We know that this geometric factor applies in trees. Every year the tree gets bigger, so the tree ring is likely to get smaller over time, the age-related growth decline. So we can have a nice theoretical curve. We can fit a straight line. That's one possible model that can be fit. But the modified negative exponential gives a declining curve. So this is a declining curve like what we just looked at in the red line.
So over the years, all the curves are showing that it is the tree, the link width, is declined.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We observe that in many trees,
yeah.
And we understand just geometrically that it's a property of rings.
Okay.
That
the
radial size is going to decline over time.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's the reason that some people use deterministic functions.
That's right.
And I'm not in a position to basically make recommendations to you all, because if you were to, there's two reasons that you're going to encounter these issues. The first one is that you need a master chronology in order to cross date samples. So everyone working with tree rings needs to understand what goes into a master chronology and needs to be able to use it to cross date their samples. Then there's a much smaller subset of dendrochronologists who are specifically, their actual research involves developing chronologies and then usually trying to relate those chronologies to a phenomenon like precipitation, to reconstruct precipitation, for instance. And so all of us need to know how a chronology works. A very few of us need to have a detailed understanding of model by model exactly how do I want to build a chronology. And I'm not one of the people who makes those kinds of chronologies. So I can say, you know, here's what Fritz says, that this could be theoretically better, but pretty much all the chronologies that I make are empirical. They're created with the cubic splines, they go up and down depending on what the trees do, because my main interest is making sure that my samples are cross-dated well so that I can move on to fire ecology and forest ecology studies. But here is another function that has slightly more flexibility called the I don't know if it's Huggershoff or Huggershoff function. It was named after a person. And so this is another deterministic function, another pre-made function that people sometimes fail to treat in data. Another way of fitting a function is to make polynomials. And so polynomial functions have a certain advantage in that they can be very flexible. A polynomial can take on a simple form, like just a simply declining equation, or it can start to decline, go back up, go back down, do all sorts of things, depending on how many terms or parameters you give it. In fact, if you put one parameter per year, then you could make it exactly match every one of your tree ring measurements, if you wanted to do that. So when you have a polynomial, there's not necessarily a clearly defined way of how you should use a polynomial and how many parameters are enough, where you should stop using it.
Is there any general recommendation, for example, in temperate region you may use it as a best fit model?
That's a question that I don't know the answer to. But it is certainly possible for someone to get their PhD trying to answer a question like that. Okay, so let's move on to the stochastic functions or empirical functions. These are basically moving averages. And they might be an unweighted mean. So we may take a moving average of every 3 values or every 5 values or every 20 values. Or it can be a weighted mean. And it can give more weight to the middle of a period and less weight to the ends, but it still may take, say, 20 years into the economy. So a running average, a moving average, can be quite flexible. If the tree ring series starts to drop and goes down for a decade, like we saw in the examples we were seeing earlier this morning, then a running average of that also will decline. If it goes up, it'll go up. If we have a very short average, it'll be extremely flexible. If we have a long average, if we say that the value at every point is the average of that point plus 10 values before plus 10 values after, so 21 data points, then it's a little less flexible. If we say it has to be 50, then it's going to be it'll move, but move very slowly, very inflexible. Does that make sense? A running mean can cause some problems. One of the problems is spelled out here, and there's a little bit of an example here. If this is our series of numbers, 12, 15, 38, 2, 46, 10, clearly this value is a very low value. It's not in any sense a peak. It is the lowest point in this series of numbers. But if we, because it happens to be around the two biggest numbers, if we take the three-year mean, it's going to have a very high value, even though in fact it's a low value. So that could be an undesirable characteristic of a spline. That's also an example of an unweighted mean. It's just three numbers. We just take the average. There's no weight given to any value. But we can weight values. So we could take the 21 years, or we could take 31 years, 15 years on either side of a central value, and we could give a greater weight to the central plus or minus 5 years, and then a lesser weight to the rest of it, and that'll make it somewhat more flexible. So spline functions, cubic spline functions, have flexibility that can be set by the user. The user can set it by deciding how long of an area needs to go into the spline. And in practice, we're going to look at the COFECHA program tomorrow, which creates chronologies, among other things. And in practice, there are menus where you can set, if you want to use a cubic spline, you can tell it how flexible you want it to be. In the program RSTAN that we referred to earlier, you can actually go core by core and put in a different model for every core. You could put, if you use spline models, you could change the flexibility. And basically, if you were really doing this for a serious research project, it would make sense to experiment and see what kinds of results you achieve with different models. This is the kind of the highlight of flexibility of a spline. It can create any kind of a shape by joining the various points. Okay, so once we've made that decision, we have our growth curve, we know how to standardize it. We either use the ratio or the difference method, so now we have for every single individual tree core, we've converted it into indices. Let's say we use the ratio method, so they all have a mean of 1. They all have similar variance. So now we can average them together. And as soon as we do that, we have finally created a chronology. That's what a chronology is an averaged set of standardized tree ring indices. And we can average it, as you might expect, in more than one way. These are the two main ways that people use. You can simply take the arithmetic mean, just the average. So in our example with the standardization, we use the year 1600, for instance. And in the sample that we had on the screen, the year 1600 had a pretty low value compared to the estimated growth curve. So the ring width index for 1600 for that tree was about 0.5. It was about halfway from nothing to where the growth curve estimated. So now we take, say, 19 more trees. Say we have 20 trees in our chronology. So the first one in the year 1600, its value was 0.5. The second tree, perhaps the value was 0.7. The third tree, perhaps it was 0.3. It's likely to be the case that it wasn't just an isolated thing that tree had a low value in 1600. Probably 1600 was a dry year. So we'll average them all together. And we may get an answer like 0.6 or 0.4. And that then becomes the index value for the chronology for that year 1600. The other kind of averaging here, called the biweight robust mean, is another form of taking an average. And basically what it does is give less weight to outlying values. Let's say that one of my trees grew great in the year 1600. That when I compare it to where I fit the growth curve to, I get a value, a ratio of like 3. So I have 0.5, 0.4, 0.3, 0.7, and 3. So that one has a great influence on the eventual answer for the year 1600. So if I choose to use the by weight robust mean, all I'm going to do is say that if a data value in the averaging process is identified as an outlier, I'm going to give it less weight. I'm going to say that probably that's an unusual thing that happened to one tree, as opposed to a general phenomenon that affected the whole stand. I'm going to give more weight to the majority of the trees. This is a comparison of the results of averaging when you use this is not showing what I thought it was showing. I'm sorry. So I have to think about it. Okay, these are both by weights. I thought it was showing by weights for and not in the mathematical average, but it's not. What it's showing is for this chronology, basically the presence of outliers. The black line at the bottom is showing where the outlying values are sitting in terms of the weights that have been assigned to them. So the weights are on the y-axis, and basically what we see is that there are a number of really strange values at the beginning of the chronology, and then one pretty strange value, unusual value, here around the year 1900. And once it has been converted to the index, the weighting is much more uniform and much smaller. In other words, the variability has been reduced. Okay, so what we have on this axis is three elements of a particular chronology. This is a fairly old chronology going back before the year 1400. And we have three things happening here. Now we are looking at chronology graphics. So these are not individual trees anymore. These are the results of multiple trees averaged together. The top graphic shows an average of the raw ring widths. So this is averaging the ring widths together without standardizing them. We see a lot of oscillation. The units over here are in actual millimeters. And we see movement over time. I mean, we have low periods and high periods and so on. Fitting a cubic spline through here, this flexible red line, if we take that red line and make it straight, it becomes the black line in the standard chronology. The standard chronology is now in dimensionless ring width index units. They have a mean of 1 because this was done by standardization by ratio. And there are still some patterns of places where there were unusual ups and downs that are still retained in the chronology. The bottom graph is an indicator of the sample depth. This is the number of samples on the y-axis. And so the maximum on the graph is 40, and we appear to be getting close to that in the early 1700s. Before 1700, at 1700 there's about 25 or so samples. At 1600 there are about 10. And then as would make sense, before 1600, it's hard to find wood that's over 400 years old in this forest. However, there are still samples back there. One reason that we often are interested in this sample depth is that you can see that it's going to change your interpretation of how you view the chronology. The chronology between about 1600 onwards has many trees in it. But before 1600, we still have 200 years here. But it's only 3 or 4 trees that are providing all that information. So we have to be a little bit skeptical. We have to bear in mind that, you know, now one tree's individual circumstances is actually kind of affecting the picture for all of them. Yeah. One tree is 25% of the data at that point. Okay, so Couple more topics related to chronology. Autocorrelation. So autocorrelation is the, as the word would indicate, is the correlation of something with itself. And in the case of tree ring data, it's a correlation of the characteristics of a tree ring in a certain year with the year before, and maybe 2 years before, and maybe 3 years before. So in ecological terms, why would the growth of a tree in 2017 be related to its growth in 2016? Why would there be that relationship?
Because it would be utilizing the same nutrient of photosynthesis of 2016 for its growth in 2017. The phenology is.
Okay. So the nutrients, the photosynthate, the growth that occurred in 2016, and we can see the 2016 growth ring produced a certain ring. In 2017, the tree is starting from where it left off. If in 2016 a bunch of bugs came and ate a lot of the leaves, and half of the growing season the tree had no leaves, it's not going to grow much in 2016. And when it starts in 2017, it's starting from a bad point. It doesn't have many carbohydrate reserves. It's going to have to try to put out leaves with the stored energy that it has. Maybe it won't be able to put out as many as it would have in other circumstances. So maybe 2017 will also be somewhat narrow, even if the bugs don't come back. Does this make sense to everybody? If a tree suffers a fire and some of its foliage burns, or if there's a drought and the tree is not able to grow very much and is not able to store carbohydrates, then that'll show up the next year too, and maybe potentially the year after that. If the tree has an evergreen habit and keeps some leaves, then those leaves have to serve not only 1 year at a time, they have to serve for perhaps 3 years, 4 years, whatever the retention period is of those leaves. Like a lot of pine trees, for instance, keep their leaves about 4 to 5 years. Some keep their leaves as much as 20 years. And there's actually a very interesting type of study where you trace back through the branch and look at the length of the needles, and you can match up the conditions of the year, sort of like dendrochronology and dendroclimatology, but not with tree rings, but just by looking at how much needles were produced each year and how long they are. So this is the persistence of ecological factors. And another term that's been used for it is ecological memory, which is a term that I really like because it captures autocorrelation. Yeah. And it helps us remember too, because the word autocorrelation is, you know, it's like another statistical term, and we have all, maybe you guys may be better at this, but for me, I find that my head gets filled with various statistical terms and then I have to stop and think what they mean or look them up or something. But if I think that it's an ecological memory, that really makes sense. And so it is often the case that we have, in fact, it's generally the case that there is the presence of autocorrelation in tree ring series. We can detect it by making a graph like the one in the upper right. This is a correlation graph, and at point zero, what I have is the current value of the tree ring index. And the current correlation of the number with itself is 1, because it's the same number. But look at the correlation with the number before. It's like 0.6. And before that, almost 0.6. And before that, 0.5, 0.4. So we have this extended correlation of a tree ring with the tree ring the year before, the tree ring 2 years before, the tree ring 3 years before, and so on. So that is autocorrelation. And autocorrelation... Go ahead.
Poorly correlated.
Excuse me?
Can we say that it is poorly correlated? 0.5, below 0.5, 0.4? More fairly
I mean,
well related,
in,
yeah.
in many branches of ecology, if you could find something that has even that explains even. Point 0.4 would be an R squared value of 0.16, right?
1.6.
So that explains 16% of the variation.
Yeah.
So 0.5 explains 25% of the variation. So that's a notable amount.
Notable amount. If the numbers are high.
Yeah.
In samples.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. It's not a correlation of 0.9.
Mm.
But it's a notable correlation. And so, if I am interested in isolating this year-to-year variability mm-hmm. caused by climate so that I can have this very precise chronology for cross-dating purposes, then I might want to try to get rid of this autocorrelation mathematically. I can't get rid of it in the tree because the tree grew that way.
Yeah.
But if I have a consistent relationship, then I can make a model, an autoregressive model, that removes the average amount of influence from the year before and tries to isolate the year-to-year variation without having this effect of autocorrelation. In some other kinds of ecological studies, back to the same theme that we were at before, if we're interested in the persistence of ecological disturbances and features, then of course we don't want to remove the autocorrelation, we actually want to study it. So it depends what we want to do. But in the case of that year signal, that development of a basic chronology for cross-dating, we often want to remove it. And so autoregressive moving average models are a model that represents a tree ring's width as a function of various factors, including the previous or even 2 or 3 years growth, and therefore removes that factor mathematically. It subtracts it out.
Yeah.
Okay. So to conclude with the types of chronologies that we have, if we simply standardize the cores and average them together, then we have what's called a standard chronology, basic chronology. If we apply this autoregressive model, then the chronology is called a residual chronology. And the chronologies like this are the ones that are most clear in their year-to-year variation. They have the least amount of ecological noise and the most amount of climatic signal, or at least they should. That's the purpose. And this term of applying the autoregressive model and then taking the residuals left behind by having that subtraction process of the autoregression is called pre-whitening, which is a really cumbersome term, I think, because it's not very meaningful in any way. It has something to do with, it comes from the information theory and like radio waves, when people were also concerned with trying to distinguish the signal from the background noise of static. And pre-whitening is a term that comes from that, from information theory. So residual chronologies have this year-to-year variability and are often the best suited for climate modeling. And what Cook did in his dissertation and what led to the RSTAN program is another more complex way of creating a chronology, which I put C. Cook because I can't explain it to you. But I didn't want to bring it up because that's the origin of the term RSTAN stands for autoregressive standardization, and it's intended to be a more sophisticated way of dealing with autocorrelation. Okay, last thing is some different statistics that come about from a chronology. So in the chronology now we've combined, let's say, 20 different cores. So some basic information about our data set is what is the first year in which we have tree dates, what is the last year, how many samples do we have, and what is their sample depth through time, like the figure we looked at a few minutes ago. So we saw in that figure, for instance, there was only about 3 or 4 trees before 1600, then it went up to 10, etc. So that's part of the basic information. For the ring width indices themselves, we have the mean, the standard deviation, and some other statistics that have to do with whether the data are normally distributed or have some sort of skew. Another statistic associated with a chronology is mean sensitivity. And the mean sensitivity is the percent in change on average for the whole chronology from 1 year to the next. So if we have trees growing in a climate where there's big differences in rainfall from year to year, and the zigzag, the movement from positive to negative is very pronounced all the time, very commonly, then we're going to have a high mean sensitivity. If we have trees growing in a climate where there's not very much variation from year to year, we'll have a low mean sensitivity. And it'll also probably be harder to cross-state those samples because it's harder to make a match of the pattern. Another variable that is used to describe chronologies is the expressed population signal, or EPS. And this is a type of measurement that's related to the number of trees in the chronology. So the formula for EPS takes into account the number of trees present at each time period in the chronology. And just as we were seeing in the example that we looked at with the sample depth, the EPS, or the expressed population signal, in our chronology there, drops around 1600 because there are very few trees left in the chronology. So the chronology is more dominated by individual trees rather than an aggregate signal coming from many trees. That's not necessarily a bad thing, it's just the way it is because unfortunately we don't have, you know, 1,000 years of trees that we can, of tree rings that we can find in every site. But it's a little bit of a signal to the dendrochronologist that perhaps if I'm interested in reconstructing climate, I may not want to do that all the way back to the year 1500 or 1400 because the influence of the individual trees is getting to be too much. And finally, the R bar. So that symbol is supposed to be just an R with a line over it, meaning the mean. It's just the standard symbol for mean, like we have X with a bar over it is the mean of X. But I couldn't find an R like that on my computer, so I had to put a dot. I found one that has a dot under it. But it's just the R, the mean R. So R is the commonly used correlation coefficient, and the R bar is the running average correlation coefficient in 100-year windows overlapping by 50 years throughout the entire chronology. So these are all statistics that are associated with chronologies and statistics that we'll see tomorrow when we run the Cofecha program with actual data. So we're going to take tree ring, measure tree ring data and run it in the Cofecha program, and we'll step through what Cofecha tells us as it created that chronology and then what we can use that chronology for. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. So we're, before we move away from the projector, I wanted to show what some of the measuring systems look like. So this is one. This is the Velmex tree measuring system. It's the web page that's producing that mess on the left-hand side, so I can't get rid of it. But what this system consists of is these components right here. This is a sliding stage. So when you turn this little handle right here, this metal stage, this metal square on top, moves, and it can move in either direction. There's a long threaded screw that runs through it, so you turn the handle, the screw turns, and the stage moves on top. Extremely low tech. It's connected, it has a what's called a digital encoder. So the digital device is a linear device that is simply reading how much the stage is moving to the right or to the left. And this instrument is quite expensive, largely because that linear encoder is really expensive. It's very precise. It can measure to a thousandth of a millimeter. It's connected to this readout that takes the electronic measurement from the encoder. It takes the electronic reading and converts it to numbers in terms of millimeters. And then the thing, this little white device that has two buttons, these are buttons that the user controls. One button sets the readout to zero. Once it's set to zero, then you start measuring tree rings. So you look through the microscope. In the eyepiece of the microscope, there is a crosshair. Or alternatively, the microscope can be have a camera that's hooked up to the computer. So you can see the tree rings either directly or on the computer screen. And as you move the stage, then the tree ring under magnification, you start at the beginning where the last year's late wood ended. You measure the early wood, you get to the end of the late wood, and you press the button. And it records how wide that tree ring is. And then you do that for another one and another one. The device that I think you're getting is the LinTab. Is that right?
Yeah.
So the LinTab works in a similar manner. It's just another company that also makes them. So you can see that the stage up here, there's a little handle that turns. The user looks through the microscope or looks at the microscopic image on the camera. And in the case of LinTab, it comes typically with a program called TSAP, TSAP-WIN. And this TSAP program allows you to see your measurements on the screen as you go ring by ring, and it can also display the measurements associated with a master chronology. So as you're measuring, you can see the whether or not the rings are lining up well with your master chronology. And it's a nice system and not inexpensive.
Yeah, maybe more expensive.
I wanted to show you all as well. So those two were involving the user moving a stage to measure the ring widths. This is a system called WinDendro that uses a scanner. So simply a high resolution scan of the tree ring sample. Then that scan is projected on the screen, so similar to looking in the microscope, now you're looking at the scanned image. And if you can see, the computer has drawn a red line along here, and then these little green lines are where the computer has detected a difference in the ring boundaries. So it's basically going from the color difference, the light wood and the dark wood, and it recognizes the early and the late wood. And then it detects a boundary, and then the next early late wood detects another boundary. And those are translated into measurements, tree ring measurements. The computer is quite imperfect at doing this. So the user has to look at the screen as well and determine whether you agree or don't agree with where the computer has chosen to put the ring measurements. But if the computer has skipped over a ring that you believe to be a true ring, then you can click on it and tell it add a ring here. If it has put in a ring that you know is a false ring, or it's just the color is a little different, but it's not a true tree ring, for the kinds of reasons that we discussed, it's not really showing late wood and a cessation of growth, then you click on it and it takes it out. So that's pretty flexible. This WinDendro system works quite well in the case where you have wood that has pretty clear rings. So conifer wood in particular is good. On the other hand, things like the diffuse porous or semi-ring porous angiosperm wood that we talked about yesterday, it's a lot harder for the computer to be able to make distinctions. The other thing that's interesting about WinDendro is that when you purchase WinDendro, you buy a scanner, like a scanner that you can buy at an office supply store, and then you buy some software. You're not buying a machine or a stage or a microscope or anything like that. And it's quite expensive. So the wind dendro company, or the company that makes it, which I think is called Regent, yeah, Regent Instruments, has priced it in such a way that many times it's a difficult choice for people to make. For us, I don't know what it would cost in India. For us, it costs $10,000. And that's kind of a lot of money. We could buy two or three of our stages for that price, so we don't use wind dendro very much. Another reason that we don't use it is that a lot of our samples are very complex, and the computer identification of tree rings, when the tree rings are nice and clear, like in this sample, then it works really well. When they're not, and there are false rings and missing rings and complex things going on inside the rings, then it doesn't work too well. So the last thing I want to show you is not online, but comes from this paper. This is a paper published 2015, 2 years ago, in Dendrochronologia. Dendrochronologia is one of the two journals that are dedicated to tree ring issues. Dendrochronological research is published in all kinds of journals, but Dendrochronologia and the journal called Tree Ring Research are the two that focus on dendro issues. So studies of methodology tend to occur in those journals. And this is a package for R to measure tree ring widths from scanned images. That's basically the same thing that wind dendro is doing, except, as you all know, the R package is free. And so this is a nice alternative for those who don't want to spend $10,000 on a scanner. And the way that, let's see, I gotta change the page. So the way that this works is we also have a scan. They scanned a very short image here. But they have a scan, there's the pith of the tree, and you can see the growth rings going out to the left, and then the bark on the left-hand side. So you need to take a disc or a core, and the part that you want to scan is this part that's outlined in blue. It corresponds to the shape of a core or a single transect through the tree. The program then converts this to a grayscale image. Yeah, there it is. So here's a grayscale image. What kind of wood would that be? Not the species, but of the types that we looked at?
Porous.
Ring porous or possibly the diffuse, because there's some pretty large vessels going farther into the ring as well. But definitely angiosperm wood, right? So you can see that now it's been converted from color to a grayscale image. It also converted it from a gymnosperm to an angiosperm between the two images that we looked at. I'm just teasing you. The first image was from a pine tree, but now they switched to this angiosperm image. But now you can see how the program is moving through that grayscale image and deciding to detect rings at the places where you go from very dark to very light. So it's making use of that visual image. If you look at the ring in the middle, that ring in the middle is quite wide and the late wood starts kind of early, so you see that it doesn't have nearly as much of a light peak and it has a lot more complicated of a dark peak. But there's still an abrupt transition at the end, so the computer was able to detect that. Like the wind dendro system, this allows you to go in and make changes. So you visually cross-state the sample, and then you can correct the scan because you know where the rings are supposed to be. I've started using this program, but I ran into a lot of problems. Most of the problems have to do not really with the program, but with R, because I'm not a very good user of R, and I run into troubles every time I try to open the file. But I'm making some progress, and possibly next week during class I'll bring in an image that we already have scanned and we can take a look and see if we can detect the rings. So these are all some different options associated with ways in which we obtain the ring measurements that we use to make chronologies. All right. Close out of here. All right. So the last, well, before we get to mounting our cores, does anyone have any questions or comments on this whole chronology development discussion?
Too labyrinthine to fathom and develop questions. But can you suggest some good books?
I think
to
that.
Start with.
Let's see. Let me just. Let's see. This book, The Spear.
Yeah.
Book steps through these elements of chronology development, and it also has a really strong chapter on Cofecha. He passed this around at the beginning.
Yeah.
And Professor Garakoti has a copy of this as well. Fundamentals of Turing Research. In the case of the R versions, there are also packages that, with each package, with the DPLR package, one gets help. There's a PDF file of questions and answers related to that. So that's another place you can turn for more info. All right. So now let's mount some cores. And in order to do this, let's do it on this round table back here. People can come zoop around. That we don't have. I wonder if somebody would go to the bathroom and grab some paper, just some toilet paper or a napkin or something. Or does anyone have some Kleenex? So. This thing is. Does anybody know what this is?
Core cleaner.
Yeah, it is a core cleaner. But it has another purpose. When you buy it.
Is this okay?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you. When you buy it, it's not called a core cleaner. Does anyone know what these are for? These are for cleaning rifles. So. Because nobody would make a cleaner just for core. So this is for a small size rifle, like a 22 gauge rifle. I'm going to show you how the core cleaning part works, and then we're going to use just the rod to help push the samples out of the cores. But if we were going to clean a core, an increment bore, then we put this together. I don't want to force it. We put a little piece of paper or a little piece of cloth in there, and then we spray some lubricant inside the increment bore, and we use this to clean the inside. The trees that we sampled on campus, because they're angiosperms, they're not very resinous. But when you work with conifers, you have to clean it a lot. Sometimes you have to clean it between every tree, because the conifers leave a lot of resin in the trees. Piece back. Okay. So I'm going to leave these out because these are smaller than the straws, and so we can use them to push the pieces out. So this is a core that I mounted, that I collected on Monday or Sunday, and let it dry and then mounted. So we have the mounting boards. They have this groove cut in them. We have glue. I know the glue was working because it leaked all over my bag. Yeah, so that's still working. And then this one is, now it's dry, so I can take these rubber bands off. Okay. I've also indicated what I knew about the tree, so where it came from, the date that it was collected, and I just said leguminous tree. I think this is an acacia, the same that we were looking at the water tower.
Leucophoria.
Leucophoria, I think. And so we'll see what happens when we sand it down. Right now, it does not look like there's going to be rings on this tree. Okay, so when you're mounting cores, one thing to think about is what you're going to be doing later on. These mounts take a fair bit of work to make. So I don't want to just mount one short core on the mount and stop. I want to use up the mount. But then they're connected to each other. So it would be nice to have them be like from the same study or the same plot. I don't want to collect some trees in one place, a different place, mount them on the same mounts, and then always be confused about what is where. For now, of course, these are all from here on campus, so it doesn't really make any difference. So, okay, but here's another acacia. I think that the numbers on these are all correct now. So there was one group, there were two groups that coordinated the numbers, and one group that started numbering by itself. That meant that at the end we had two number ones, two number twos, and so on. So for some of them, it's the original number is crossed out and there's a second number. So if you mount one of these cores, please use the second number, not the one that was crossed out. And we'll put the species name and the number on the core. So this is, there's a 2A and a 2B. Let's see, there's 2B. So 2A and 2B, probably these will fit. And they're also acacias, and this one I think was an acacia. So I'm going to go ahead and mount them on the same core mount. I'm going to also, this was the inner part of the tree. The pith is somewhere around here, off to the side. And this is the bark. So I'm going to mount them in the same direction all the time. Again, because when I'm working under the microscope, I don't want to suddenly find it backwards. All right, so let's try 2A. Now, the only label that I have for this is on the straw, right? So if I take both of these out of the straw, in 1 second, I'm going to forget which one's which, and then I'm going to lose the information. So I like to just work one sample at a time, go through the entire process, and then come back to another sample, then start on the next sample. So, it is so much more humid here than where I live. You can see it in even the paper. Well, that one might not be the same acacia, because that wood looks very different. Okay, so this core came out in one piece, so that's nice. But as you know, many of the cores we collected were in pieces. We tried as hard as we could to put them in the correct order, not to drop them and stick them back together and stuff. Well, if we did that, I know that there was one core that I was handling that we dropped a piece and we picked it back up. If we put it in the wrong place, we're going to find out now after we look under the microscope. So you always want to be really careful from the moment of collection to conserve everything in its correct order. And as it's coming out of the tree, you want to like have the other person maybe hold their hands under it, come very slowly. You don't want to pull it out of the tree and have all these pieces go flying. That's no good. Even if you find all of them, it's very hard to get them in the back in the right place. Okay, so now, this is easy though, because I have this one sample. I want the cells to be vertical in the tree. There's actually some of the samples that I brought from the US have tree cores that are mounted sideways. That is, the tracheids are mounted facing horizontally instead of vertically. And you can see the difference even without looking under the scope. Tomorrow when we come in, or at the end of the day today, look for some of the core mounts over there that say mounted correctly and mounted incorrectly. The incorrect ones are mounted sideways. And you'll see how much more difficult it is to distinguish the rings. You can still see the rings, but you're looking sideways at the tracheids, and they're much less clear. You always want it to be mounted vertically. How can we know which way is vertical?
It won't be slanting.
The cells will be straight, but how do I know which way the cells are? The answer is to be found at the end of the core. These fibers, where it broke off in the tree, these fibers are oriented in the same way that the tracheids are oriented, or not the tracheids, well, the fiber tracheids in the vessels in this tree. So if I make these fibers go up and down, you see the fibers at the end, the broken part of the wood? If it's like that, then that's horizontal. But if it's like this, then it's vertical, mm-hmm. the way it is in the tree. So that's what we want.
Very clear.
Okay, so I'm going to want to glue this like that. Let me make sure. Yeah, there's going to be plenty of room for the other one. So I'm going to want it to be like that. It's also okay to be like this. In other words, we don't know which is the top or the bottom, and that doesn't matter. They just need to be vertical. But I'm not going to do it this way because this end that's popped up, it's harder to get the end to be flat. If I do it this way, it has a bump in the middle, but the middle with the rubber bands I can pull down more effectively. So I'm going to do it like this. So now I set it here, and I take some glue. And I use... If I use too much glue, it's going to spill out, and I have to clean it up. But if I use too little glue, then it might not stick. And the sample, when I put the sanding machine on it, it'll go bing and fly away. So we don't want that to happen. So again, I check that the fibers are vertical, and they are. If you guys look closely at the one that I did the other day, they're not vertical, which makes me mad. I screwed up. Okay, so I press that in, and then I don't want to use all the paper at once. So I clean off excess glue. Now, in order to do a good job of pressing it in, I turn it upside down and I press like this because the flat table pushes better, you know, more consistently across the whole core than my fingers do. So now I feel good. That's in there. Now I take a rubber band. I come in to the end and I start this kind of a process. Oops. My finger's stuck. Sorry. It's easier to do on the part of the sample that's closer to the end. I may have to stop pretty soon. Even do that. As long as I have some pretty good coverage holding it down pretty consistently. And this is why it's good to have the bump in the middle instead of at the end, because that part doesn't want to come up. All right. So now I need to note the information about this core. So this was number 2A, acacia, bucofolia. Okay. pH.
pH L O E.
pH, but folia should be O L. Mm-hmm.
pH L O E.
Alright.
pH O L E.
Yeah, I think it should be pH O. Alright. We'll make the next one be that way. And it was on 12 December 2017. Okay. And the next one, so that core is done now. I also recorded in the field, we noted down in the notebook all this stuff. So this one's done. If I just leave it sit there, then when I do the next core, all of a sudden now I have multiple labels sitting around. So get this thing out of here. And put it away where it can't cause any problems. Okay. So who wants to do the next one? You want to do it? Go ahead and sit down. It's better to be close to the table. Thank you. No one has a
dog here.
You can also, you don't have to cut it off. You can open it. You have to open the other side too. Yeah, you can just unfold it. Maybe that's easier. So where I live is a very dry place. And this kind of paper, this exact paper that we use for the cores, I can always rip it because it's always dry. Okay. That was fine, but next time, go ahead and push it all the way through. Because if it was broken inside and you just pull it out, you're gonna separate it from the